we want to use auditing as a tool to be able to establish good practice and to enable and support all our staff to understand what good looks like, starting with case reports and personnel audits. They also looked at the IRO service, the Independent Reviewing Officer service, and they say that the team now have a real sense of stability within the safeguarding unit with good leadership and management. What they told us when they came out was that there was less of a stability than there currently is, and that the IRO cases were too high. They are now where they should be, and each IRO will have approximately about 85 cases, but it's up to about 110 cases when our staff come out. So you can see that we have strengthened that team, but not only in terms of numbers, but in terms of stability and management. Those are the three areas of the looked at. They also told us that there was still a long way to go. And I think that the theme of the inspection took on very, very quickly, that they established and they recognised that we've made progress, but we also recognise that we're not there yet, we've still got a long way to go. I think it was a good theme for the inspection, and the inspection outcome from the monitoring visit was a healthy place to find ourselves in, and things have started to shift. Staff are telling them that things have started to shift. And I think one of the ways to recognise this is that we've recently transferred, I think it's 9, potentially 10 agency staff who have been working with us, who have moved into taking on roles within the authority. And we have about 23 further inquiries from other agency staff. It's not a quick fix in terms of you can't just be an agency staff and become a member of staff. You have to evidence that you are a good, strong member of the staff and you will be an asset to the borough. So it's not the case that you can get a job in Wirral where you may not be able to get an inquiry out at all, but you've had some issues in your career history. That's not what we're looking to do. But where agency staff are starting to take on more permanent roles, it shows a sign that things are starting to stabilise a little bit within the culture of the team, because otherwise they wouldn't have done. And the agency staff told us some years ago that that's not what we're looking for, so things have started to shift a little bit. We keep just putting every little thing in the back. For the long way to go. Okay, another thing that we've been on with is the improvement plan, which will take us through the next phase of our improvement journey. The first stage of the plan saw us establish and set up, and it also saw us, and I was able to report last time, that we had done quite a lot of ticking off tasks that were completed at the initial start and the first phases and the early phases of that plan. I also told you when I last came out that we were going to look at the plan. So this is reporting back on what we've done. I also want to say that this is not the council's plan. It's not. It's Wirral's improvement plan. It's not Wirral Council improvement plan. So all parts have played into this. I still think there's a long way to go in terms of establishing closer relationships and closer working across the plan with our partners. But I think we've made some good inroads during the period of time since we last reported, and there's been a number of multi-agency meetings to get us to the position that we're in. The Wirral Improvement Plan and the Strategic Framework for Improvement and Transformation has been brought together. So in terms of the changes that are internal to the council, we've looked at more governance arrangements so that we're not doing things in isolation, and it builds on the good evidence, such as the work that you've heard through Ian earlier, Ian Hassel, around how we are working in partnership. So all of those things will be able to be locked back to somewhere around a joint and shared governance. And I'll come on to what that means for the council and its transformation, the investment in children's in a minute. There are 5 key pillars that we think covers the very broad aspects of where we need to generate and continue to generate improvements. There's the right service to right time, which starts with our early help offer and works all the way through in terms of intervening at the right time and in the right way with children. It protects the most vulnerable and ensures that they succeed is another key theme. All have actions behind them. We provide care and support for our children, and that's predominantly around our looked after children. And then the 2 bottom ones, the 3 top ones were around delivery and activity, and the 2 bottom ones are promoting strong leadership and governance and making sure that we celebrate work with our partners. To become anything that requires improvement to evidence very, very strong partnership working with partners. So not only joint working arrangements, but joint commissioning arrangements, evidence of sharing resource and planning budgets together, those kind of things, to make sure that we spend the rural pound very, very wisely. It also ensures that there are not multiple planning tools and that the focus is clear, whoever you are and wherever you are working, where you are working and engaging with children and families. The delivery against actions are allocated across a range of parts and service areas, so partnerships at the strengths, and this includes something that is we've called the sprint approach, and I'll come on to the sprint approach in a second. Consultation took place over the summer. It took place with a wide range of groups and individuals, and we are calling the plan a live document. So it's not a final draft, it's a final draft in the case we finished and put it on the shelf. This is a live document, so the iteration of various version controls will continue as we progress through the plan. You've just come, some of us, this afternoon's meeting with the local safeguarding board, where there was quite a lot of active conversation around what this needs for individual partner organisations, Vicky Smiles, because some of those conversations and discussions are really, really challenging. And that's reassuring that there's a lot of challenge around bringing this to the table. It's not a done deal, it really is pushing back on all sorts of things that we're not quite sure where those are going to come from. But I emphasise that this is a shared plan and a shared approach to get the best outcomes for our children. This just comes on to demonstrating that there is a performance framework that sits behind this. So you've got the five themes at the top that run across the bar at the top, and I just want to bring you on to the green bar there that talks about sprint actions. What we have, and it is very pertinent to our council corporate colleagues, is that we have a series of sprint meetings indicating they're quick, they're focused on actions, and deliverables to move us forward. So it's kind of the bigger picture is going to be a 3-year plan to get us to where we need to be. Then how do we get there? And the sprints are evidence of how we get there. Some of the things that we need to move forward are internal to the council. And we also are very responsible for the investment that the council's made through transformation. Hence it's why we wanted to join up in terms of the governance arrangement. So the design authority around how we move forward with our transformation colleagues will see all corporate players responsible for taking action forward for our children. Where do our care leaders live? Which houses do they live in? What happens to our children when they're out and about in the evenings? Who manages that when they get into trouble, when children's services aren't here in terms of the service offer? What happens to our young families and our adults in our communities? We've heard a little bit this evening. So the sprint actions, we've had a plan for the first 12 weeks, so we're just about to complete and move forward with the next sprint actions for the next 12 weeks. So it's kind of bagging a series of activity that will take us forward, and I'll tell you what that might look like in a second. We have clear outcome measures, and we have a process for measuring those outcomes against the impact of the plan. So we've moved away from a series of activity. I think it was about 114 or 15 actions in the first plan. A high number of those have been achieved at the point that I reported that last time. But we then start to get into the so what factor. How do we ensure that the changes are sustained and that the changes are starting to impact on children and young people? This is a little bit about some of the sprint achievements. So the column down this side here have been the activity that has gone into weekly sprint meetings and return week on week, evidencing how they move forward. So accommodation, there were some immediate issues for accommodation for our social workers in particular, it was social work teams, and I think that some of you will have heard that some of our social workers were in very poor accommodation. So we've been able to respond to that with immediate actions to change and put right what was not working for our people. And we can see that the Rock Ferry offices, that we've made quite a lot of change there, including going back to the cleaning contracts and making sure that things were put right. including that we put a kitchenette in the room for the staff to make themselves drinks. There wasn't one before. We were worried about health and hygiene. Staff were using the toilets to fill up kettles. We confiscated about 13 kettles and 11 toasters, I think, when we went out to have a look, where they set up little stations for making drinks. And that's what happens. And we've replaced carpet, and we are currently, I'm not sure how it's going down, and I've not had any feedback today, but we have little black boxes that we've put under the desk to look at activity and usage of tables. It won't monitor who's there, it's not people that are watching what's happening with staff, but it's looking at how frequently our desk space is used. That's going to help us to change culture. We want our staff to be more agile, we want them out in communities, we want them to access their IT and equipment in very, very different ways, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But before that, we have to know, what's the usage of office space? So, does every member of the staff still need a desk if we get agile working around? What affects, how does it affect culture when staff haven't got desks or if they're working in offices in a particular type of way? So it's generating a lot of interest activity around our future offer so that we understand better and it's not just a second guess at what we think we understand. In terms of HR, there has been new processes put in place in terms of managing sickness, that we've looked at back to basics training for every member of staff, and we're a long way down that process. So every social worker and practitioner is going back to basics in terms of what does good practice look like. And staff are coming back to tell us that this is really, really, really important to them, just to revisit, just to give a confidence around, have I got this right, or are the things that I need to know. And we've embarked on that in a wholesale way for the service area. Reward and recognition in terms of recruitment and retention long term of our social workers has been a big piece of work that is just about to go live, and then we'll go very heavy on recruitment drive. So we've seen some change in terms of staff recruiting to key posts, which I've reported previously, and where staff are converting from agency into permanent members of staff. But we need to have a whole host of recruitment drive around quality staff and social workers. But before we could do that, we needed to understand some of the remuneration and some of the retention issues that we were facing, which includes monitoring the sickness and speaking to our staff. Our staff themselves, in terms of social workers, they are paid at a very equivalent rate to other local authorities in the nearby boundary areas and aligned with the region. Our managers, however, aren't. And we are not retaining and we are not recruiting to manager posts. We've known that for a period of time, which is one of the challenges for us. The sprint is a way in which we've been able to unlock that by doing this activity and feedback and then moving on very, very quickly. So we're just about to go live with that. We're currently discussing with unions and then we'll take that out to staff. Practice improvement has been another big area in terms of a 12-week sprint with weekly updates in terms of the care leave service. That's been a really clear example of where we've been able to move and evidence that we're moving at pace and with grip. We are currently reviewing all policies and procedures. We're looking at LADO and what's happening when we access through services that need to be embarking on taking forward issues through LADO. We're reinvigorating the practitioner forum. So there's a lot of work happening there around the sprint meetings. Finance, revision of the cost of the service is a bigger piece of work that's happening. And there's another way. So we've got sprints and we've also got wider projects. So there's two wider projects that feed into this at the moment. One is around data and performance, knowledge and information around the service to inform what money we're spending. And the other is, and what activity we're undertaking, sorry, and the other is a financial review, an end-to-end review of finance, budget and resources. And we have Andrew, who's working with his colleagues on a bigger piece of work, which is being fed into the budget planning meetings, but also being able to advise and move forward on a day-to-day basis as well as the longer term. Digital, I will come on to in a moment, and I'll just show you a way through how our sprint meetings have worked. And then the final area there that has been in and out of the sprint meetings is a campaign development and implementation to change how people see and view our people, particularly reports out there, and got the biggest reporting on how many people are using particular narratives. So it's just about to improve and change the view of involving people and our elected members in some of that. I'll just move us forward to have a look. So this is one of the sprints, and this is the Mobile and Agile Working Project, which is currently going through a proof of concept. So we have 16 of our frontline practitioners who now have new equipment, very, very up-to-date, modern ways of working with equipment that is going to see us move forward into the future. The proof of concept in terms of agile working didn't need very much proof, really, in the local authorities, and particularly those that have been in a position of where we are now in an adequate judgment from Ofsted, have moved through this as a way of working, a way of engaging their workers. But we've taken a little bit of a step further. We've worked very closely with the digital team. We've got some fantastic equipment, but now we have 60 people that are trialing. But into week two of the trial, we had feedback that the improvement board, when it was very new, they'd only had it for a week last week, and they're telling us that already it's starting to make a difference. So working through on the sprint, was it all plain sailing? Well, it wasn't. We reported regularly, I reported regularly to the chief executive, senior leadership team, to enable us and ensure that my colleagues around the director's table could help me talk about issues that were happening or not moving quickly enough. We had problems with connectivity, we had problems with building the kit, wanted to receive the kit in terms of the capacity for that team, and together we were able to make sure that it happened and it got back on track. So overall, from start to finish of that, there's been a 2-week delay. One of the weeks was where it was outside of our control, but our contracts team and our legal team were able to step in and make sure that the contracts around connectivity could move us forward. As a children's services leader, I don't think I could have done that on my own or fully understood how things could have moved forward if I'd been left my own facts to do it, which has probably been some of the ways that we've worked in this step. So all staff are trained on the new Lenovo devices with Windows 10 functionality, and that's the ambition for the council as a whole. And they've had kits along with feedback and capture diary that we'll be able to on a week-by-week basis feed in to make any changes as the rollout happens. They'll analyse feedback and assess feasibility, and then recommendations to SLT for wider rollout will take place. But I think the very early information is that staff are kind of liking this kit. They're able to have children and people put things straight onto the almost like a tablet form. You know, their own update, or they can draw a picture on there, and it's captured on the children's case notes with almost immediate effect. We have made quite a lot of progress around sickness, and I know that this has been something that has been an issue and a challenge for the service and for many of you who have fed back around some of the concerns that you're picking up as we report progress around sickness. If I take you down to this bit here, I'm just finding it's not plugged in. If I take you down to this line here, the Children and People's Department, the outturn is 10.8 days on average per worker. The council as a whole, the outturn is 9.8 days. So we are nearly aligned to the rest of the council. We're not suggesting for a minute that that is where we want to be. We still want to improve on that, and I think Wirral generally is probably has high sickness, but we are there and thereabouts with the rest of the council. However, the top of that, I want to report to you that the sickness average for full-time equivalent days for children's social care is currently at 15.8, and that's because we've done a really deep dive into social workers, because that's where we're also having capacity issues, both in terms of using agency work to build in more social workers, but also where we are covering for staff and where we are having problems with. Of those 15.8 days for children's social care, 77% is long-term sickness, and people get sick, and people do get ill, and we're not trying to manage this in a punitive way. And 35% of that can be attributed to mental health issues. What I want to say there, though, is that the... I'm just checking this on here. For that 15 days lost, we are talking there about seven social workers. That's all. So when we drill right down into an area, and it gives us on average for a very much smaller number, 15.8 days. That's come down from 18 days, but that equates to 7 social workers. So it's not the numbers that we're dealing with. In terms of the use of agency, workers continue to be high due to both the additional capacity that we have grown with establishing additional posts. It's currently running at 34% of the workforce. The establishment in terms of social workers in post, the full-time equivalent, 26.7 are newly qualified, 34.7 are social workers, 38.5 are experienced social workers, and this represents a shift to a more experienced social worker role post. And I think, again, the experienced social workers are starting to stay with us. It was at that point that we started to see a downward trend where social workers would then leave and more find jobs in the local authorities, and that's showing an upward trend, so I think that's quite helpful. We've also built in additional team support officers. That's the specialist admin around social workers, and that's currently now at 1 to every 7 social workers will be an administrative role. Advanced social workers to social workers, there is 1.1 to 5, and team managers to social workers is 1.7. So there is spans of control in terms of the management. And again, they were much, much higher, and in terms of the targeted, the team support officer, that was much, much lower, and social workers were telling us that they couldn't record, they couldn't plan meetings because they didn't have any administrative time to do that, and they spent a lot of their time away from the base. It was all the things that were making things pretty uncomfortable for the social workers. You can see we've started to make some positive change. Work with our children and young people continues to be very active around the improvement world, and I just wanted to share with you a couple of achievements by two of our care leavers who have recently graduated. One's a social worker who was looking to apply for a job in the role, and the other one's acting, and we also can actively support them on their next leg of their journey. I think that's absolutely fantastic. The Children and People Reference Group that sits aside the improvement board is looking to do its own improvement plan against the improvement plan. There was a date that went out there, and they're going to meet again to write their version, complete their version of the plan. Because they also keep it on track. That's a group of youngsters that meet monthly, if not just regularly over the summer, because they've been busy doing other things, hopefully playing and exciting things that youngsters do. They take this very seriously. 10 of those youngsters are trained as young inspectors and want to work with scrutiny. There's a plan to meet some of those youngsters going forward. The annual youth conference, many of you have attended the annual youth conference, and that's just to let you know that's taking place on Tuesday the 10th of October. And it's our young people that plan and deliver that conference. And a takeover day where youngsters can join us as part of the workforce or take over our jobs the day is on the 24th of November. One of the things that we have said, I do need to put a feedback to you, I'm sure this evening just make a note, is that it could be that
Which was a little bit crazy to say the least, and that is now 21.
is managed and monitored, and I know you've got a copy of this tablet. This is just some safeguarding performance, just some headlines, and I don't expect you to be able to kind of rehearse this back because it's kind of really deep stuff. But in terms of the rate for children subject to a child protection plan, we're currently on a downward trend. We've seen a massive spike in child protection plans in and around middle of 2015, and it continued to be high. That has come down, thankfully, and at the end of August, it was 55.4 young people who were subject to a child protection plan per a population of 10,000. That sees Wirral within the target range and similar to both our statistical member group and our regional partner groups. So we're where we need to be with that when we look at the trends for other places. The rate for a second or a subsequent child protection plan, so these are referrals back in, moved from red in June to amber in August, so it came down again in from June to August. That measure has fluctuated massively over the last few months, so whilst we're saying we're coming down the trend, we're not taking our eye off that, because it has gone down and back up and down and back up. We don't really understand the reasons behind the reasons for it going back up. The referral rates are quite high, but it's just keeping our eye on that. Children referred to early help and involved in the team and family. Referrals to early help from social care has increased by 246 between quarter one to quarter two in 2017. And I think that reassuringly, cases that are closing to social care and stepping down to team around the family has increased massively from about 7% earlier in the year to 22% of cases closed. So that is probably where it needs to be. But again, that's something that we'll also keep a very close and we'll make a watch on. And this was noted by an increase in the number of TAF from 807 to 1,437 across the first and second part of this year. This is potentially very positive. It shows more children receiving help earlier, which should hopefully start to see. It's early days in that yet, but that's the trend that we would want to be able to demonstrate ahead of starting to demonstrate low needs in social care. And we just need to keep our eye on these things. The number of children in care has continued to increase. We have now topped the 800, we're at 810, which is the highest number to date. Wirral has been higher than statistical neighbours since about 2011. Now, what I would say is that all the local authority region in the North West region, so 23 authorities, I've got the data for those, and they're all on the upward trend. We've seen where some have impacted and come down, but started to rise up again. The problem Wirral has is that it started higher. So the trend is going up at the same rate as other local authorities, but we started from a place of being higher with our numbers. So we continue to be a bit of an outlier with this, and something that we want to keep our eye on. I think in the northwest region, where it's saying 82, I actually think that that is now about 87. So from the last quarter's data to this, which is kind of hot off the press, I picked up at the meeting very recently, that's increased. We've got some of our northwest colleagues reporting, I think it's St Helens that reports it's 113 per 10,000. So very, very high. Still very, very high for them. Focus remains on reducing numbers of children in need, stabilising the workforce and training to improve performance. Sorry, that was a very long talk today, so I'll hand it over.
Thank you, Anita. So I'm going to go for the questions and comments now.
I just really wanted to talk about on the whole of care.
On item 14, the report it talks about a report that will be completed by the end of August related to homelessness for 16 and 17 year olds. Is that available for disabled? I don't know. If it's not, we can get that. I don't know where it's up to, so I'm not personally seeing that report. Have you seen that?
No.
No. I think that's something that I'd say would be interested in seeing children and the support as well.
Yeah.
And just in terms of, I'm sorry, these pages aren't numbers, but on happy, safe, achievement and the best for our children, 3F4, it talks about initiates a joint workshop with planning, I think that should be housing, because there's no workshops planned for planning.
So just read that again.
So develop a performance framework which considers how effective we are in managing these cases need to be developed so that both children's services and housing can be effective for these children. Initiate a joint workshop with planning and housing.
Okay,
I'll
have
to read
that.
I think, from my perspective, and I'm just here as a reserve on it, on this committee, but I can certainly see that there are some improvements, still a long way to go.
There is.
There's certainly, from my perspective, certainly a lot of it that have come a long way from where we were. One of the things and one of the comments we would like to make about the report is there's an awful lot of acronyms like vaccine and things like that. It might be nice to have something. there's a couple of things there that perhaps for people generally to read this report, it might be there nice to have.
So, it would. I agree entirely. It's not something that I've not been told about before. Yes. The landlord is the local authority designated officer, so that's where there has been.
Target number that
that we need to be looking at? Is it, is somewhere around the I think it was 48 when they the lowest number. It is a retarded number, do we know what it is? I mean, only other final point is, I think it's all fantastic what's going on. Should we congratulate Ofsted? Because if Ofsted hadn't said we were in an probably a lot of this would never have happened. Yeah. Is that a fair comment?
Yes, it is, and that's a fair comment. And when Ofsted were out very recently, you kind of are hesitant about 2 days and kind of sweaty a little bit frequently. But actually, at the end of the 2 days, it would have been really good had the company stayed longer, because we were kind of saying that we want to just demonstrate this and there's the opportunity to start to demonstrate that. And they are working with us as part of the improvement partners. They do challenge, they do offer rigorous scrutiny to that, and it is under inspection conditions. But I think it was a very healthy feel to being able to start putting in question and evidence when we're starting to make progress. So that was the first one, so I agree with that. The child protection numbers which you've brought there, I don't think there is an ideal number of child protection cases, and it will fluctuate depending on a number of things, such as your deprivation levels, your population levels. What you were higher, what you do is you look at other local authorities, you look at statistical data where there's more of a likeness to what you are, and you do a lot of case auditing, as well as saying the key in terms of case auditing. And of course, every child protection case has a social worker, it has an independent reviewing officer as well. So those are the kind of measures that we take. I don't think there's an ideal number, but now we are kind of on that median line with colleagues. We would want a downward trend, because what we're aiming for is children's needs to be met much earlier than when there are signs of significant harm to those youngsters. And so that's always the ambition, to reduce what's safe and to reduce. I think that you're probably referencing the child looked after levels, and we are very high. Another common trait that is particularly pertinent to Wirral is that when a child comes into the statutory arena, so that level 4 or safeguarding child protection child in need areas, they tend to stay longer than other local authorities. So that's the analytical data that we get and we look carefully at, and that tells us that we need to be looking at that. For a child that's out of the family for longer than 6 months, it is very, very difficult to integrate a child. And again, most of this is on research and practice that we know this thing. And then the third question of the care leaver service, the impact on care leaver service. I think there's some high-level data, such as the number of visits, the frequency of visits, the engagement, what's actually in a child's individual pathway plan. So you may not be able to measure the whole service on that, but you'll be able to measure on how many of the outcomes of each individual youngster are met against their pathway plan, their transition journey. I'm going to just ask someone if you want to come in with anything, and then there's Ian at the back of the document. I'm answering thoroughly enough on that, where there will be performance indicators against that service area.
We normally look at measuring for care leavers in three distinct areas. We look at whether we're in contact with care leavers. And if you notice, one of the things that Ofsted said is that we were in meaningful contact, because actually just texting a care leaver or dropping a note through the door is not the same as having those regular conversations. And by that we mean face-to-face, going out to see them, making sure we're talking to them, knowing what's going on for them. And I have to say, being in touch with all but one at that level and one refusing to have those conversations with us is absolutely, you know, spot on performance, and we need to keep that up and keep that engagement up. The next key measure for care leavers is whether they're actually living somewhere that is good for them, in the right accommodation. And, you know, Deborah talked about some of our concerns about where our care leavers are. We do have a high proportion currently in the correct accommodation, but that could still be higher. We're still working on that to ensure that, you know, every care leaver we can say with confidence is in the accommodation we want them to be. And last but not least on the formal measures is whether they're in employment, education or training. And again, we're doing well on that measure. It was again something else that Ofsted pointed out to us, that we've managed to engage our care leavers. Now again, we would want every care leaver to be, if at all possible, in employment, education or training, and were there not, we want to plan. And we've been working hard to put in apprenticeships, we've been looking for as many opportunities as we can for our colleagues, and again, our team are absolutely fantastic. We've had a range of opportunities for apprenticeships with the council, which weren't being taken up in quite the way they should do, because some of our care leavers haven't quite engaged, and we were getting towards the end of that time, and I said to the team, come on, what can we do? They went out that day, they went and sat down with care leavers, they took all the information out, they came back, and we increased the uptake on that, you know, on that day, because they're absolutely passionate, our team. Where there is an opportunity for our care leavers, they want to make that change and that difference. So there's the formal measures. Absolutely, as Deborah says, pathway plans, are they meaningful? You can look at those. But I would say one of the most important group to get feedback from, and by Jove, will they give you feedback and let you know, is our care leavers themselves. And we're very proud of wanting to encourage them to have a voice, to tell us what they think. And I'm sure there will be a group that I'm looking at Ian that would be more than delighted to come and tell you what's and all about the services they've experienced, and how we can be really good at providing not only care leaver services, but services for children looked after.
Yeah, thanks very much for the report. It's just a question, a statement that you made, it's got me somewhat perplexed. 5.8 sickness days. You said it was mainly 7 social workers. Is that 5.8 an average of the 7? Or was it 15.8 an average of the 7, or 15.8 an average of the workforce? I didn't quite understand.
The 15.8 is the average of the workforce that is within that cohort. So we've chosen a much smaller cohort than the rest of the service, where you can see things have improved, because that was a much higher across the service. We've looked at that across the service. We're then doing drilling down. We want to know why we have signs of sickness, how we can manage that. This is a stressful area of business. They're exposed to all sorts of ailments. They're going into households and places where people's health is compromised, and they're out on that front line. So we want to know what it is and what makes our social workers ill, and how we can improve their health, and how we can make them take responsibility as well for their own health. So for instance, the flu jab, we've got very, very little takeoff. So we're just doing a little campaign around that, because we want social workers to be able to access and have that flu jab. It's available, they're not using it. But the cohort that we've looked at, it is 15.8 days, I think it is, for that small cohort. And that is largely to do with 7 social workers who are currently off on long-term sick.
More questions on that?
Sorry, not really a question, just an observation really on procedure. And I think it was an excellent presentation, really comprehensive, and I enjoyed hearing it. But in future, can we have it a bit earlier? I know Alan did a great job in sending it to us on Friday, but given it was so weighty and the discussion was so lengthy, I think in future, we could, as committee members, could have it earlier, then our scrutiny of it would be much improved.
Absolutely, we'll try to do that, Councillor. I think some of it is things like data and also information. So the Ofsted information